Was the covenant of grace always administered after one and the same manner? I told you in the previous question, two covenants, covenant of works and covenant of grace. So where did this covenant of grace start? Genesis chapter 3 verse 15. So once it starts from 3:15, it's all the way through Revelation 22. There are two parts, the old and the new. These two parts are part of one covenant, the covenant of grace. How many parts? Two. The old and the new. But which is this covenant? It's called the covenant of grace. Usually we think the Old Testament is part of the first covenant. No. The law is also under the covenant of grace. You understand that? Why is the law part of covenant of grace? When you broke the first covenant, should you be given a chance? Should be dead. But through the law, we studied the dispensations. We have innocence, after that we have promise, conscience, then human governance, promise, law, and the dispensation of grace. Why was the law given? And law did not come immediately. Stepping out of the garden, we have the dispensation of conscience. Then human governance. Then comes the promise. And then comes the law. Step by step, God is teaching man that he realizes how precious grace is. Is it not God's grace that we have the conscience inside? Is it not God's grace that we have the promises? It's God's grace that he gave the law that we can know how we can walk. Otherwise, man would have been dead by now. So let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 3, 6 to 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, 6 to 9. I am reading. Also, who also hath made us able ministers of the New Testament? Not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth, but the Spirit giveth life. But if the ministration of death written and engraved in the stones was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how shall not the ministration of the Spirit be more glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. So can we see the covenant of grace is not an administered in the same manner? I want you to look at that scene. Moses coming down from the mount. In his hands he has the law. Is his face shining? If that law, or that, here we read, who also hath made us able ministers of the New Testament, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter killeth. What did the law do? It killed people. But the Spirit giveth life. Why is the law killing people? Can man obey the law? Can he obey the law? The law is there. He says, I'll do it. But why is he not able to do? Who rules his life? Sin is ruling. So can you imagine, it's out of context, if all these Old Testament saints, if they could walk and God is pleased with their life, then how much more easily we can walk? Yes? If that law that killed Moses' face shined, look at the way we will shine if the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit is revealed through us. Right?
So then it's the same way.
But
it's just more.
Ministration is different.
It exceeds.
Exceeds. And how it was administered, it's not the same. But it's the covenant of grace that it killed. So many animals are slaughtered. But here, what is that covenant doing? Giving me life. Let's move on to the next question. How was the covenant of grace administered under the Old Testament? Question number 34. How was the covenant of grace administered under the Old Testament? Romans 15:8. Can someone read?
Now I see that Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God, confirmed the promises made unto the fathers.
So, how was the covenant of grace working in the Old Testament? Number one, God has given promises. Are you able to understand that? Number one, what do we have in the Old Testament? You have to hang on, cling on to the promises. He has promised he'll do it. And these people, how were they righteous in the Old Testament? How did they please God? By believing those promises. They just believed. You said it, I just believe. And did God count it to their righteousness? So just imagine, if I believe these promises, are these promises there for me also? But has he not fulfilled those promises in Christ? Is Christ everything for me? Well, look at us. Number two, Acts 3:20.
And he shall send Jesus Christ, which before was
Verse 24.
Yea, and all the prophets from Samuel and those that follow after, as many as have spoken, have likewise foretold of these things.
So, number one is promise. Number two, prophecies. Prophet after prophet is coming and prophesying. Read it again. And he shall send Jesus Christ, who before was preached unto you. The prophets were pointing towards Christ. Ye and all the prophets from Samuel, and those who follow after, as many as have spoken, have likewise foretold of these days. It's not something out of the blue that's happening in Jerusalem. Old Testament is pointing towards the cross. So you have the promise. Number two, you have the prophecies. Prophets are coming and they are prophesying. Next, Hebrews 10:1.
For the law, having a shadow of good things to come, and not the very image of the things, can never with those sacrifices which they offer year by year, continuing to make the comers thereunto perfect.
Here you read, for the law, having a shadow of good things to. What's the law? It's just a shadow of the good things that are about to come. Not the very image of the things can never with those sacrifices which they offered year by year continually make those who come to it perfect. So, what do they have? Promises, prophecies, and sacrifices. They are offering so many sacrifices. Unknowingly, I committed a mistake, I have to offer. Every morning and evening, there are sacrifices. Then yearly, you have the Day of Atonement. So many sacrifices, but they never had a clean conscience. They're having a satisfaction that, yes, the sacrifice has been accepted by God. So how is grace manifested? We studied till now. Promise. Yes, promise. I'm not going to kill you. Promise is there. Number two, about what? The lamb is coming. Shadow of that, they are taking those lambs. Number three, you are supposed to be dead. Instead of dead, bring a clean animal. Can you imagine? Example to help you understand. You broke the law. You broke the law and you committed something. Some mistake. Or you murdered someone. And everyone says, it's the death sentence. And all the hearing, everything is over. And the day of judgment comes. And you are standing before the judge. And what does a lawyer say? I tried my best. But I don't think I'm able to influence the judgment. And what are you staring at? Death sentence. But then as the sentence is given, the judge says, I sentence you to life. Will you be... What will be your reaction? You're supposed to be executed. But what has he done? Turned it into life sentence. Does a heavy burden lift from your heart? Yes? Same way. It's just a weak example. You should have been dead. Offer a sacrifice. And when you see that, why that sacrifice? God doesn't want your blood. But when you see that innocent animal struggling, something happens here. Does something happen? I don't know about you. When you see that animal being slaughtered, I've never seen a goat or any animal being slaughtered, but once we were traveling in Nepal, we were just going, in a car we are going, and then right in front of us, on the road, a goat is tied to the doorpost, and the woman is holding the leg from the behind, and that man has that axe, man, I turn my face. I can't look at it. I'm just giving an example. When that animal is being slaughtered in front of you, does something happen? That's why he gave the sacrifices. And that's grace. In your place, an innocent animal has been sacrificed. Next, let's move on to Romans 4:11. And he received the sign of circumcision. Yeah, someone please read loud. And he received the sign of circumcision, a seal of the righteousness of the faith. Again, I'm saying, reading, a seal. Circumcision is a seal of the righteousness of the faith which he had yet being uncircumcised. Was Abraham righteous before circumcision?
Yes.
That's the reason that circumcision is given as a seal of that righteousness, that he might be the father of all them that believe, though they be not circumcised, that righteousness might be imputed unto them also. So how is this grace, covenant of grace, administered? They have the seal of the circumcision. That seal is there, a sign is there. They have that faith. So look at these people in the Old Testament. They don't have the infilling of the Holy Spirit. The price has not been paid. They have the law. They have the conscience. But still, are they able to walk? Are these Old Testament saints able to walk? They walked. So then, what's the excuse for us? What's the excuse? Look at them. Abraham just had the promise and he held on to it. Just the promise. And then, as a seal of his righteousness, he gets that circumcision. So how did they look at God, and how am I looking at God? God told them, offer the son. I have told you about him. We have studied about that. And he goes. God promised him Canaan. And he buys land. And he is there. Example. Why is Abraham telling Eliezer, under no circumstances are you supposed to take the boy to get a bride for him? Couldn't Abraham get a bride for his only son from Canaan? Is he mighty? He chased away 4 kings, all by himself. He's so mighty that Abimelech came and made a deal. He has 300, how many army men? 317 people are there in his house. Why can't he make a marriage alliance with the kings who are already there in Canaan? One son. Is he a good young man? He is 40 years old and not married. Yes? An excellent character. Why is he not getting a son, a bride for him from Canaan? Think and tell me. His faith. Can you see his faith? If I get a bride for him from this Canaan, what about the promise then? I'll give you this land. If he has a marriage alliance, then he can't drive away his in-laws. He has to make a deal with the in-laws in Canaan. I have been promised that this land is for me and my seed. The girl will come from Haran, not from here. Can you see the decisions? Are we that mature in our decisions? Look at this man, just with some promises, and how mature he is in his decision-making promise. Condition. His son, no, you're going to get it from there. I don't want anyone to lay claim on this land. God has promised it to me. You see another thing? Before he dies, he sent away Ishmael and all the sons of Keturah. He gave them gifts and sent them out of Canaan before his death. Why? This is for Isaac. If he doesn't do it before he dies, you know the problem now in Israel? The Jews, they say it's our land. And the world is mad when Trump said Jerusalem will be the capital. Why is the world mad when a country decides that Jerusalem is our capital? Why is look at the world, what's wrong with you? If someone comes around and if suppose Canada comes and says, hey, Trump, we won't accept Washington DC your capital. From now on it will be Los Angeles. What will Trump say? Shut up. That's my country. Who are you? But look at Israel. Jerusalem is their capital from old, and the world says no. But can you see the faith? The decisions he made. Is there anyone telling him? Any pastors? And suppose, I have told you earlier also, if suppose Abraham comes and sits here and he says, what's going on? This is Bible class. What do you do here? We study, we write notes, the PowerPoint is there, we have video, we have everything. And he'll say, you're doing this for what? We are learning how to walk. And he'll say, you learn? I had no one. Yes, we are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses. And what are they saying? If we could just cling on to that promise and finish our race. You who have seen the fulfillment of that promise. You have seen the fulfillment of that sacrifice. Why is it so hard? And they are not in the bride. They are the friends of the bridegroom. And we who have been chosen to be his bride. Look at us. The circumcision is there. 1 Corinthians 5, 7. Out therefore the old leaven, that ye may be new lump, as ye were unleavened. For even Christ our Passover. So next, they had the Passover every year. First is promise. Number two, prophecies. Number three, number four, Number five, the Passover. Every year that Passover is there, reminding them about the deliverance that's about to come. And can you see how everything clicks that very night after the great Passover meal? Not before. After the Passover meal, he took the bread. Because that Passover is showing, and that was the last Passover for man. Because the Passover has been, here it says, is sacrificed for us. So, after the Passover, before the sacrifice, you have the Lord's table. Connects to the New Testament. Can you see the connection coming? After the last Passover, he's not taking the bread after he rose again from the dead. Before the crucifixion, can you see him? Connecting, bridging the two. Takes the bread and takes the wine. The wine that shows Christ. So along with that, you can just write down, later on you can read Hebrews chapter 8, chapter 9, and chapter 10. These three chapters, you see the types and ordinances, which all show towards whom? Christ. Hebrews 11, 13. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. Can one of you read?
These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth.
Were their sins forgiven? Were the sins of all these people who obeyed forgiven? Or does God hold those sins accountable before them? I'm talking about from Adam till Christ.
Sins can only be covered by sacrifice.
Yes. Does God see those sins? Yes? No. Are their sins forgiven? That's what I'm asking. When you just do what I told you, you obey, because all these are pointing to whom? Christ. Yes, they are covered. What does covered mean? Will God lift it up again and say, hey? The blood shows it has been dealt with. So, did Christ die for all those who come after him, or for all those who were before him also? He has died for all those who were before him, and the price has been paid. Can you read Galatians 3, 7 to 9?
Know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. and the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, In thee shall all the nations be blessed. So then they that be of faith are blessed with faith to Abraham.
I'll read again. Know ye therefore, verse 6 onward, even as Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness. He believed, and it was accounted for righteousness. Know ye therefore that they who are of faith, the same are the sons of Abraham. Example, just stop. Now, back in India, it happens like that. I don't know how it works here. The moment some money comes into my account in the bank, I get a message that this much money has been credited. Will I be happy? No. Last few days ago, when I came from India, it was the second or third day, I just watched my bank statement online. I was checking, and there were two debits. 206.52. And I am thinking, man, who has taken that money? This is just 206, and that's how much? $4. $4 have been withdrawn. Two times. So I am saying, I called my children, did you do anything? And they said, no. Then who has taken this money? If someone takes money from your account without your knowledge, will you be happy? But if money credits into your account, same way, God credited into Abraham's account what? Can you relax? He has already credited that righteousness. Why? He believed the promises. If I just believe those promises, will heaven be pleased? Are we not wearing the breastplate of righteousness of Christ? All that I have to do is what? And then, and the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the Gentiles through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, In thee shall all the nations be blessed. Today many people are clinging on to the Jews. They say, pray for Israel. Yeah. There are a whole lot of people today. Pray for Israel. You know why? What's the principle behind it? We get what? Because we think if we hold on to the tail of that Jew, we will be blessed. And the Jew looks at us and calls us dogs. Yes? The Jew looks at us as though we are dogs. You are uncircumcised. We won't allow you to enter our temple. Yes? The law was given to them, and we cling on to the law that was given to them. I am in Canada obeying the laws of Israel. Does it work? The Canadian law is for the Canadian people. The Israeli law is for whom? It works in that land. But my goal is anyhow blessings. See, the truth or the fact is, the Jews have to come behind us to be blessed. Right? Aren't we more blessed than the Jews? You want the Holocaust? Yes? They say the Jews are so blessed. Look at them, what they went through. They went through hell. But thank God, God opened our eyes. The one for whom they were waiting, they he came in their midst and they could not recognize him. Thank God. We were able to recognize him. The privilege we have. So how is the covenant of grace administered under the Old Testament? Number one, promise. Number two, prophecies. Number three, sacrifices. Number four, circumcision. Number five, the Passover. Number six, the ordinances. And here we see, and then Genesis, Galatians 3:14, that the blessings of Abraham might come to the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. So why was Abraham blessed? Because he was good? Was it not because of us? Are you able to understand? In thee shall all the nations of the earth be. Why? Not because of Abraham. The seed has to come. And through the seed, who has to come? We all have to come. That's why who is blessed? Abraham is blessed because of whom? Us Gentiles, who through Christ will come to that union with whom? With God. So can you see? God called that man Abraham from Ur, brought him to Canaan. Not just like that, he had a purpose. Can you see God preparing the ground before Golgotha? When did the preparation for Golgotha start? In the Garden of Eden it started. Can you see God making his moves, bringing the advance party to? Yes, is Abraham the advance party? God brought him. Told him about Lot. He came out. He didn't. Finally, he had to go. You look at everything. Gave the promise. 400 years brings them. Can you see everything is working around what? A declaration has to be made from the cross. And what's the declaration? It is finished. One hanging on the cross joins the hands of God and man. Can you see his hand stretched out? Uniting whom? A God who is justice. And the blood has been spilled. And now, after that, are they one? So how did it work in the Old Testament? Is it clear? Question 35. How is the covenant of grace administered under the New Testament? Mark 16:15.
Mark 16:15. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature.
Go ye into all the world. Do you have a choice? Sterling. Why does he tell us to go? And whom is he telling to go? Those who have that relation with God, that relation has been restored. We who once ate that muck, enjoyed that muck. It's through us God says, you go. And what are we supposed to do? Preach the gospel. What is gospel? What is gospel? The good news. What's that good news? Just simply tell me, what is that gospel? God is love. Where is that person? You are supposed to go and preach to whom? Where is he? You have to go and tell. No need to lie there. The price has been paid. Do not try to do some good works here. Just believe on the work that has been done on the cross. Are we not supposed to do that? Next, Mark 28, 19 and 20. Matthew 28, 19 and 20. And Jesus came and spoke unto them, saying, All authority is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. So how is the covenant of grace administered under the New Testament? Number one, we are told to go. The gospel has to be preached. Number two, those who obey, they have to be baptized in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Why baptism? Through baptism, what are we saying? You have already believed in Jesus. So through baptism, what are you saying? Why is it a command? That I am publicly demonstrating my faith, that I am uniting with Christ in his death. I am identifying with Christ in his death. That's why water baptism is that serious. Next, 1 Corinthians 11, 23 to 25. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, 23 to 25. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, that same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you, and this do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do as often as ye drink it in remembrance of me. Number two. Number one is, we have to go. Number two, baptize. Number three, in his remembrance, take part in the Holy Communion. 2 Corinthians 3, 6 to 9. We have read that. Can you please read that again?
And if the ministration of death, written and engraved in stones was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfast to behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory was to be done away, how should not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious?
So, I just want you to understand how privileged we are. Through water baptism, what have we done? What have we proclaimed? In the Old Testament, they sacrificed an animal. In the New Testament, through water baptism, what am I saying? I am dead and buried with Christ. Is it not God's grace? I should have been dead. But instead of that, I got the good news. What was the good news? As I told you that example before, you were supposed to be killed. You should have got the death sentence. You did not sleep the last night. The evidence had clearly said. So when the judge announced that you have been given life sentence, a heavy burden lifted from your heart. Right? But then, after a few days, someone knocks at the door and he says, "Sir, you are free." "What? I am free?" "Yes." "Why?" "How? Has my sentence been reduced?" "No, sir. Nothing has been found against you. You have been acquitted." Yes? Have we been acquitted or has our sentence been reduced? We all were sitting here. Has our sentence been reduced or have we been acquitted?
No condemnation.
So when you come out of the jail, you're sitting there and you are wondering, "Man, how come?" Reason is, someone took my place, accepted the guilt. There was no chance for me. Yes? And does my conscience prick me that I am guilty? Yes? No. Though I have been acquitted, do I know that I am guilty? But the good news is, "Sir, you are acquitted. But there is a request. Now don't live for yourself. There's someone who's there in your place. Now will you live for yourself anymore?" You're living for whom? That's why we worship Him. We are not interested in our house or car or anything. If this is how much He cares for me, I'll just do what has been commanded. And I'm there at the prison about to leave. "You have to live for Him." "Yes, sir." Anything He says is my command. His will is my command. I'm stepping out of this prison. I had given up all hope. There was no chance. Thank God. We get baptized. He says, "Get baptized in water." "Yes, sir." No questions asked. "I'm identifying with you." That's why we go into the water. Why we go into the water? So that I can walk in the newness of life. Lead a life that's victorious. And then, the Holy Communion. Though I am baptized, I remember His death. That reminds me of where I was. Along with that, please read. So, if the Old Testament was so glorious, how much more glorious are we seated in heavenly places? When they saw Moses, they ran away. They said, "We can't." He had to put a veil. Is that same God who descended on Sinai inside me? Next, can you read Hebrews 8:6? "And now hath he obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises." Please, someone read.
"But how hath he obtained a more excellent ministry? By how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, apostle, he's the mediator of a better covenant, which was established before the other promises.
Verse 10 and 11 also.
And this is my covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my laws into their mind and write them in their hearts, and I will be to them a God, and they shall be to me a people. And they shall not teach every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, Know the Lord. For all shall know me from the least to the greatest.
That's going to happen in the future. But thank God, when the children of Israel are waiting for their Messiah, thank God I am blessed. Matthew 28:19. Once again we read that verse. How is the covenant of grace administered under the New Testament? Number one, we have to go. That's the command. Number two, water baptism. Number three, Holy Communion. And we have a better, do we have better promises? Are we blessed? Are we privileged? Is he worthy of worship? Anyone has any questions?
It says the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm. The law came through Moses. And the law was, why we say grace and truth? The law was pointing. It's a shadow. Reality is whom? One hanging on the cross. What came through him? That's God's grace. I'm again asking, what did heaven achieve by allowing sin? A bride who loves him. Is it true? Does the bride know the heart of God? Did Adam know God the way we know? His relationship with God was just on the basis of everything that's provided. But Adam never knew the heart of God. What a blessed privilege we all. He worked in us and he's still working on us. We are not constrained by some laws or by some dogmas. We are constrained by love. So as we are about to pray now, the same question he asked Peter after rising up from the dead. Do you love me? That's why the bride is crying out for one simple thing. How long will you tarry? I want to see you. That's the yearning of the bride of Christ. I want to go. I have heard of you. I want to see you. Shall we close our eyes and bow our heads and pray?